Angelina Jolie Pitt, thank you for taking time to talk to us on Focus on Africa. You have been very busy. You've visited various camps that are hosting refugees in Europe especially. What have you learned or have you seen that we are not being frankly told about?
That you're not being told about? Well, I think you're doing a great job on BBC, certainly, to cover these issues. I think there are many other news networks that could cover better and in a more comprehensive way. I do think, of course, when you are in a camp or in a situation and you meet people face to face, and as I'm sure you've done, it's something that you can't communicate in a news story. We can't kind of possibly explain to the audience what it is like to really sit with these families and hear their voices. I think so much in the news is about the desperation or the people and when they're at their wit's end or seeing them almost aggressive trying to get through a border or very emotional. When in fact, the reason I love working with displaced people and refugees is because I am so inspired by them, by how much they are able to overcome, how close they are as families, how aware they are of what matters in every single moment just to be alive, how they pull together, how they will give you the last piece of bread that they've had. I've been on a border of Syria where a little girl gave me her last, shared with me a little cracker that was something that she'd been given and a barrette, and it was the last thing, you know, I imagine she had. But to be a generous person and be a friend was what was more important to her.
In a refugee camp, at the same.
Yes, and you see that more there than you see walking down the streets in a regular country. So there's a generosity, there's a kindness, there's a humanity, there is a strength that is, I think, could be represented more.
Now, many of the refugees who are, or migrants, should I say, who are trying to get to Europe are fleeing conflict, some are fleeing persecution. Mm. There are others who are also fleeing what we call poverty, you know, economic refugees. Mm. Who or which of the groups is more justified to get resettlement, do you think?
Well, I'd say every human being is justified in trying to, and it's noble to try to make a better life for yourself and your family. But there is a difference of a refugee and an economic migrant, and a refugee is someone who has to leave. They're in fear of death from persecution and war. And an economic migrant is somebody who is in need of making their situation better, but is not living necessarily in a country where that country itself is oppressing it and its right to live. The line is a bit gray, of course, because when you say a migrant, you know, that doesn't mean that these people migrate for many reasons, and it's not just the obvious war like the Syria. There are some young girls I met from Mali who were fleeing from genital mutilation. There are people who are, for ethnic reasons, being persecuted within their particular section. There are women who are being persecuted in different
so
parts
of the
world.
For you weighs a lot heavier.
A refugee is fleeing war or persecution, and economics is something that is, it's very difficult to have to put it on a scale. The only reason we put it on a scale is, of course, because there is a lack of funds and there's a lack of space. And so it is very important to, when you are dealing with this area only has, 10,000 people will be moved from this place to this place, so these people will be given priority, who should it be? Yes, I believe the person who is, bombs are dropping on their house and killing their children and they have absolutely no way to survive in the place that they are at. I believe that should be put as priority, and legally that is put as priority.
One of the issues that's come up again and again is the fact that now there's a lot of talk since the crisis in Europe emerged and all. And we're forgetting that there is the Middle East and Africa who are also facing quite some pressure with regard to refugees. But I'll particularly speak about Libya, which has a very unstable situation, mm-hmm. and that is helping with the human trafficking. Mm-hmm. I wonder what you think would be or should be the responsibility of countries that intervened there when it comes to taking care of the refugees now?
Well, I think, yes, I think all countries that have the ability to help should help. And I think countries that have had a hand in a conflict at one stage or another should, of course, keep their eye on the ball where they were, where they played a part, and do what it is they can. There's also argument that sometimes you want less involvement from those same people. Libya, of course, is a country of great concern because it has gotten to a stage where it is quite lawless, and the traffickers and when we see the boats and the migrants on the boats, you know, a lot of people are benefiting financially from that, and many from Libya. I think one thing that could be focused on more is accountability and for these crimes, for this trafficking. I don't see many people arrested for this kind of behavior, but who to arrest them? You know, where is the? Would it be local police and army? No, not from a country that is not with a stable police and army and government. So these are the bigger questions on how. Even if it was to say this country should help, what exactly should they do? We have to bring law and order to these countries. We have to stabilize them.
How much leverage, though, does the UNHCR, the agency that you are a special envoy for, does it really have? You know, I mean, if you say a few countries or some countries should be asked to take care of situations like Libya, what can you do, really?
It's a very good question because often people, as you very well know, they and I think a lot of the leading countries in the UN would like to almost make people believe that the UN is this kind of separate body, and it is of course the member states. It is made up of the member states, and if the member states don't want to intervene, they'll veto. And if the member states would rather not handle a crisis with diplomacy, they would rather just make another aid appeal and deal with it that way, and kind of some blue helmets and put it over, and they'll do it that way. And it gets very complicated, and it gets very gray into what is best for each crisis, and it is not always being taken care of in the way. For example, the funding. UNHCR gets its funding from the member states. We have in Africa more displaced people than ever before, about over 17 million. The funds are, in some countries, it's less than 3% funded, the appeals.
It's a good thing you've mentioned Africa, because
How does somebody in UNHCR find that balance or give that extra food or get when it's simply not there? And then they fight. I know my own agency, we fight to say this appeal must be met and this appeal must be met. But when the headlines are all about certain countries, these forgotten conflicts really suffer. And in Africa, I think these countries and conflicts and people are really suffering.
How much priority then have you given to the intra-continental conflicts? For instance, you mentioned the continent Africa is holding about 17 million refugees.
Internally displaced.
Internally displaced, or otherwise, really.
Yeah.
Do you focus on them as much as you'd focus, for instance, on what's happening in Europe?
I do, yes, of course. I mean, I think it's the work that we do, but it's so yes, I've traveled to those areas. My concern is for Dadaab in Kenya and for that camp, and if that camp closes, we're working in Ethiopia, as we have been for quite a while, but working on a TB AIDS clinic, but very conscious of the amount of refugees that Ethiopia has, also the amount of famine Ethiopia is
facing. What do you make
of
the Dadaab closing?
Well, obviously, I'm very concerned about it, and not just because it is, there are so many things. There are so many things that I think it makes you, what it deals with. It deals is one of the reasons they say to close Dadaab is because they speak of terrorism, but there isn't that kind of proof that this is coming from this camp. So it's this fear. It's fear, using fear and spreading fear, making people more less tolerant and less open to their brothers and sisters from Somalia. These are families, these are majority women and children, these are people who have been suffering a great deal for a long time. The reality is they don't have a stable, safe place to go back to. There have been open returns for a while, and about 22,000, I believe, have voluntarily returned, but there cannot be forced returns. So this camp closes, and where exactly do these people go?
Right. Our viewers really will not forgive me if I don't ask you whether because now you're writing for movies quite a lot more. You're a star. You're known on the continent for your fantastic films. And I'm wondering whether you have particular African artists that you would like to work with in future.
I don't know if work well. I love Angelique Kidjo, but I don't think I can sing. So
did you say Angelique Kidjo?
Yeah. I won't be able to work with her, but I love to listen to her. I'm very close friends with David Oyelowo and Jaimin Hansu, and would love to find projects to work on with them. And there are a few projects. There are a few African-based projects. One is about the all-African orchestra in the Congo. My friend Armand, and something I've been working on for a while and would like to produce. Mm. So many things, and I hope that also African artists will bring things to my attention, and a few have, but I'd like more too. So I've got my ear to the ground, and I'm hoping to find more projects to work on.
A 10-second message for women across the continent.
Oh. My message to African women is that you are some of the strongest women I have ever met in my life. And I've learned so much from my beautiful little daughter, my Ethiopian daughter Zahara, who has taught me. She has a grace and a poise that is born from generations of who she is and what is in her blood. I admire African women. I think your voices must be heard stronger. I know who you are in your families, in your communities. I think you deserve respect. And I think where I get most upset is when I hear about lack of opportunity or oppression, or even, of course, I work with on sexual violence in conflict, forced marriages, all of these things. Which we must all stand together. I stand with you as African mothers to fight against this. These are things happening around the world, but it is also happening very much in Africa. And you are extraordinary women, and I know that if given the tools and given the support, you will help your own countries. And so we're here to back you.